Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, today is Friday, January 17th, 2014, and this is Friday Night Fan Fights number seven, yes, indeed. And again, I reiterate, for those of you saying your intro is too long, please feel free to go watch another stream, because this is how I do it all day, every day here, nerd, and you're just going to have to deal with it. Welcome back to Friday Night Fan Fights, where you, the StarCraft II fans, play each other in best of threes. I commentate, and then at the very end, we find out who the final boss is. And today, we have a lot of people, and I mean a lot of people, waiting inside of the chat room, and I cannot wait to see what kind of crazy matches we're going to see today. Maybe a little bit shorter than usual today, as I'm getting off to a little bit of a late start, and I have a lot, and I mean a lot of work to get done, but that is not going to stop me. No. I think tenacious is going to be the word that I will use here. Tenacious will be it's going to be the word of the day. Tenacious is certainly the word of the day. I am emphatically excited to be bringing you Friday Night Fan Fights number 7 here on twitch.tv/Invicta. Also coming at you on the VODs, youtube.com/Invicta316. And we are already in game number 1, series number 1. And I am looking forward to this. Oh, I can't wait. I cannot wait. The players are ready, so good luck, have fun, and we are inside game number 1 and series number 1 here on Friday Night Fights number 7, spawning on the top left-hand side of Habitation Station, and I think my sound's muted. There we go. Turn it on. Spawning on the northwestern side of Habitation Station, playing as the Pink Zerg. He is a Silver Leaguer. He goes by the name of Dwarfy. And spawning on the northeastern side of Habitation Station, also playing Zerg. He is a Bronze League Zerg. He goes by the name of Matrixu. So already kicking it off here on Friday Night Fan Fights numero 7. anything past Cinco, I just forget. I just automatically, it goes out of my vocabulary, and I am just done dizzle when it comes to Espanol. Yeah, 1 to 5 is easy. After that, it's all bets are off at that point. And it is going to be a ZVZ for the opening battle. We haven't seen too many ZVZs here at Friday Night Fan Fights. It's been a little while since we've actually seen a ZVC. I think we had one a couple of weeks ago, but it's already been, can you believe it? Can you already believe it's already been 7 weeks? This has been the 7th week of Friday Night Fan Fights here on my YouTube channel and on my Twitch channel, of course. And if you're watching this on the YouTube VODs, again, I cordially invite you, I welcome you to check out a live showing of Friday Night Fan Fights. It's a lot of fun, and you can come out and check the intro that all the Butthurt Beverlys complain about, because, oh, it's too long. Oh, yeah, a minute and 24 seconds. That's super duper long. Nerd, you're gonna have to deal with it. You ain't doing nothing better on this weekend, nerd. Get it out of your head and watch some StarCraft here, as we do have a spawning pool coming out here. It's gonna be a 15 pool opening for Dwarfy on the other side of the map. Looks like Matrix going straight for the gold expansion here on Habitation Station. Oh, Matrix, somebody has been watching a little too many Bronze League Heroes, I think. And Matrix is a Bronze Leaguer, so it could very well be he is a Bronze League Hero too. The gold league, the gold expansion to 10 spawning pool build. Gotta love it. I gotta love it. In the opening fight, it's ZVZ action. My least favorite matchup to play, but it's my favorite mirror matchup to watch. Let's put it that way. Absolutely hate playing ZVZ here. We do have an extractor, very early extractor coming out for Matrix. And again, will Dwarfy spot the gold expansion? You bet he will. You bet he will, with this flying overlord going overhead as opposed to a walking overlord, because... And Matrix asking for a pause here. If you're going to pause, you might as well do it, Matrix. Not sure what Matrix is wanting to pause about, but he has the ability to pause here. So I guess I will pause. Again, we are going to be dealing with a... We are going to be dealing with a non... I don't want to say non-skilled. That sounds too mean. I will say that we are not going to be dealing with any professional league players today, except maybe possibly the final boss. We'll have to wait and see. Hint, hint, hint. Nudge, nudge, nudge. Kappa troll face. You have 20 seconds before I remake and get someone else. All right, there we go. So I am making sure that everyone knows that this is not, again, this is not going to, this is tournament style, but this is forced tournament style. I'm not going to be, I'm not going to be letting someone pausing and holding up the show here. This is got to be a very fast-paced action game. So we have Dwarfy now going for a spine crawler rush. And unfortunately for Matrix, he did get supply blocked there by the Queen, and I don't think Matrix actually know. Matrix has no idea that the spine crawler is going down, so we'll have to wait and see what will happen. I don't know if Matrix is going to be able to spot this. Oh, he's got the Overlord. He is going to spot it. Matrix does know about it, and immediately every single drone, run drones, may have pulled a few too many drones off the line. Dwarfy gonna cancel it. He is going to, All right, so Matrix will be completely fine making a defensive spine crawler of his own, and Dwarfy's drone is just going to, he's just going to leave here. Again, normally if you do see your opponent taking the gold expansion and you're trying to spine crawler rush them, you would normally not spine crawler rush the main base. Go for the expansion that doesn't have any workers or any defenses at all, and that's exactly what Dwarfy is doing now. Taking a look on the production tab, we do have 6 links coming out here for Matrix, and that's going to be it. There's not going to be a queen at the natural expansion, of course, and Matrix does he does see this spine crawler here. So he is going to respond by just simply not doing anything. So where are these Zerglings going? We'll have to wait and see. Is now 6 Zerglings can take down a Spinecrawler barely. And will these Zerglings go for the Spinecrawler? The answer is no. Nope, not going to happen. And now Matrix, let's go on the Matrix cam. We are on the Matrix cam right now. Matrix, he's there, I swear. And a little bit of Spinecrawler micro coming in from Dwarfy now, as Matrix is unsuccessfully trying to block the Spinecrawler. He sent the Zerglings to the other gold base, by the way. One drone being completely obliterated by the Spinecrawler, and we just have another drone making sure that the Lings are doing their job, and no micro coming from the Lings. One Ling actually getting flung on top of the hatchery. More Lings coming out here for Matrix, and Dwarfy's Spinecrawler will finally get taken out, but not before delaying the mining heavily on Matrix's side. But that's quite all right, because he's floating 1,400 minerals anyway. And Dwarfy saying, well, if I'm going to make one, I'm going to make 4 more. Going up for the super-duper static defense at the natural expansion. Metabolic boost coming down here for both of these players. Actually on both an equal timing. We have a Banalinguness coming out here for Dwarfy, the Silver League Zerg player in the first game of the first series of Friday Night Fanfights number 7. And again, Matrix did get the gold expansion at a pretty opportune time, I will say. And again, Matrix kindly donating another Overlord to Dwarfy. So Matrix will again be supply blocked, and that is quite all right. How many larvae does he actually have? Matrix has 7 larvae, so if he needed to, theoretically, he could make 7 Overlords right now and get unsupply blocked. Lord knows he can certainly afford it. And take a look at saturation. Slightly oversaturated here in the natural expansion for Dwarfy. Main saturation looks fantastissimo. And I'm pretty sure that's not even a real world real word. Double Evo chamber coming down here for Matrix as well, as he needs to get the saturation on his main base figured out. He does have a queen spawned. They're just kind of chilling out here with the Zerglings. She's doing her nails. She's seeing if she needs any. Her hair did, possibly. Her nails did. Something along that line. As Matrix is still going to be supply blocked, and he finally is going to be making those Overlords. Again, he does have a venerable trust fund in the bank. Zerglings nicely just walking by each other, as Dwarfy is going to go straight for the third base here, which is technically at the natural expansion, and I think Dwarfy may be a little surprised to see that there's another base going up. But again, it's not going to be that big a deal. I highly, highly doubt that Matrix will suffer game-ending damage here. Although he is pulling every single drone off the line. Again, not that big of a deal when you're floating 2,500 minerals in the bank. And drones now being pulled off the line to just continue mining. Queen there, kind of making sure that the drones she's a beacon, I guess. A beacon of retreat, if you will, marking the point on the map where the drones need to be retreating to. A second queen here at the natural expansion of a Matrix. Actually, not. I guess I'll call it a natural expansion. It's close enough to the main base. It's a natural expansion. Why not? I'll have it noted that she probably hasn't spent any of her energy there. Again, it does look like Matrix not going for the workforce, the task force, if you will, cracking the whip on the Queen, making sure that they've got full energy just to they work at their leisure. They're a leisure based. It really is a tough position, and you do have to let your queens kind of rest sometimes. Arm supply tab, surprisingly low for the amount of action that we've seen at 11 minutes and 23 seconds. Matrix still floating at right around 26, so he hasn't quite broken the 30 supply mark, but that's quite all right. He is going to be able to take a queen out for his troubles, even trying to get a creep tumor there. Unfortunately, creep tumor did embed itself in the ground before. Oh, wall of spine growlers! And Matrix says, I will beat you with sheer will. No, run, run, Zergalingus, run! Oh, they stop to attack a creep tumor, and then they pay for it. So, Matrix, four army supply. That's right, I'm pretty sure it's only queens. How many larvae does he have? He does have 10. No, he's making 14 drops. Why, Matrix? Matrix, you made a roach warren. You had plenty of money and plenty of larvae. You don't need drones right now. Oh, man. Dwarfy exploding now with army supply. 39 to 8. Luckily, Matrix has got... He's got the economy in the bag. I will say that much. Just put it that way. All right, so Matrix making sure his economy is still in good shape. And we've got a lot of banelings. 8 banelings morphing on the west side of a Matrix's main base here. And will this be game-ending damage? I wouldn't have thought it would have been game-ending damage, but luckily he does have drones. Long distance mining at his natural expansion now from the gold expansion, I might add. And a Banelings detonating on the lair. Instead of going for drones, instead of going for the roaches, they made the wise decision to just take out the tech of Matrix, and now Matrix is not building anything. And GG is called! Game one goes to Dwarfy, the Silver Leaguer, taking it over the Bronze Leaguer. Oh, man. What a way to kick off Friday Night Fan Fights numero 7 here on twitch.tv/Invicta, as well as on the VOD, youtube.com/Invicta316. And yes, Twitch has been very, very slow today. Let's put it that way. I have been catching the buffering, and it's partly to blame LCS, I'm sure. But I've been noticing a lot of slowdown today as well in Twitch. So Matrix takes game. No, I'm sorry. Dwarfy takes game number one from Matrix. And Matrix may have had some technical difficulties. We're not quite sure. He did ask for a pause there at the towards the beginning of that game. So again, it is going to be a Bronze Leaguer taking on a Silver Leaguer. We're not expecting the highest level of play. We're not expecting any sort of Gosu micro or anything like that. We are just expecting for fun. Again, if you would like to have a chance at playing in tonight's Friday Night Fan Fights, join the group, the North American group chat, Sinvicta, on the North American Battle.net server, and I'll try to get you in as best I can. We'll be doing 3 matches today, depending on length, that's all I have to say. So just asking to make sure the players are ready. It's best of 3. And Dwarfy apparently has not watched the show before, so we have a newbie viewer here, as Dwarfy apparently didn't know that it was a best of 3. That's right, we're loading it on up. The map is going to be Yeonsu, and I need to make sure that the scoreboard is right. I've got the one on the right side, because that's the side that Dwarfy looks like he's spawning on. Of course, as soon as you get into the game, all bets are off, so here we are, and nope. Nope, scoreboard's wrong. It's got to be on the left-hand side. Herp-a-derp-a-derp. I don't know how that keeps happening. So here we are, game number 2 in series number 1, spawning on the southwestern corner of the map. He's currently up one game to nil here in Friday Night Fan Fights number 7. He's a Silver League Zerg player playing as a pink Zerg. His name is Dwarfy. And spawning in the northeastern corner of the map, playing as the green Zerg. He's currently trailing 1 game to nil. He's a Bronze Leaguer. He goes by the name of Matrixu. So a ZVZ here, game number 2 on Yeonsu. One of the... actually, Yeonsu's not a bad map. I was playing on it, doing some unranked games on Yeonsu. It's not actually that bad of a map for Zerg. It's not the best map, but it's also not the worst map I've seen. It's certainly better than the Habitation Station, I will say that. I will say that. It's also better than Heavy Rain. But we are going to have... let's see if Matrix is going to change up his build a little bit, as the early gold expand would have worked. Unfortunately, he kind of overreacted to the Spinecrawler rush from Dwarfy, and then he not only got supply blocked once but twice, but he also did not go above 30 supply for that entire game, and we're certainly not going to hold that against him. It's just a little bit lousy. Dwarfy looking like he's going to go again for a 15 pool, 15 hatch here, possibly, as we are opening up game number two in the first best of three. No, Dorfy's actually going to be moving out for a 16 hatch, or maybe not. Maybe not. Yep, it is going to be a 16 hatch there. Coming out from Dwarfy, 16 hatch, 15 pool, possibly. But these two are Silver League and Bronze League, so I have absolutely no idea what the heck they're going to do. That's the fun, because it's Bronze League here. No, just kidding. It is not Bronze League Heroes. That is on Wednesday. And by the way, don't forget about my weekly programming every Wednesday, Thursday, Friday here on twitch.tv/Invicta. All shows starting at 8 p.m. Central, 9 p.m. Eastern, and 6 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. Wednesday, Bronze League Hero Wednesday. Thursday, Tryhard Thursday in League of Legends. And of course, you are watching FredNet Fan Fights here in StarCraft 2. It is a lot of fun. It is a lot of fun. We have 15 pool, 15 gas coming out here for Matrix. Is he going to try to do some kind of Zergalingu all in? And Matrix... Matrix again, going for the ninja expansion here at the 3 minute and 34 second mark. Very good timing whenever you want to take base number 5 on the day. That's very, very good indeed. So Matrix trying to take a page out of the good old special Zerg tactics book, because he is going to be taking the ninja expansions. Fortunately, Dwarfy, even though Dwarfy doesn't actually see anything, he's opting for 3 hatch before gas. Yes, indeedy, yes, indeedy. And that is major, major league meta-breaking for Matrix. And, oh, Matrix, I adore you. I am automatically rooting for Matrix. I really do try to be as unbiased as possible in this. But Matrix, the fact that Matrix has the comeuppance to go for the hidden natural expansion, not once but twice in back-to-back games versus the same opponent in best of three, that fills my bronze leaguey heart with joyous and happiness. So we do have double gas now coming out for Dwarfy, and it looks like he's going to be going for some more Banalingus, or possibly going straight up to Mutas, as we have the early metabolic boost coming out here. Actually, not early. It's actually a pretty nicely timed metabolic boost, considering the fact that he ran away halfway across the world to establish this one hatchery there. And he will have the metabolic boost first. We have double Spinecrawler coming down, so it does look like Dwarfy is going to rush straight to Lair, going off for Mutatech on 3 bases. Of course, anything can happen, because we are again, talking about... we're talking about... well, they're just kind of special in a Bronze League-y and Silver League-y sort of way. So it may not be exactly what I'm thinking of, but normally if you would see a player go for this early gas, even though he's not actually grabbing his third and fourth gases as well, if you are going to try to rush to Mutas, the first thing you want to do is make sure you have 2 bases that go straight, drop down your third and fourth extractor at right around the 44 supply mark, but we're not going to see that because Dwarfy is both players now supply blocked, so there you go on that. If we were playing the Day 9, or I'm sorry, if we were playing the Bronze League Heroes stream at drinking game, everyone would be taking 2 drinks, because you drink every single time a player gets supply blocked. And yeah, it's not a double shot, but technically I guess would be if both of them get supply blocked simultaneously. And queuing up 3 overlords now, Dwarfy is going to win the race for getting unsupply blocked quicker, as we are going to have that lair now starting for Dwarfy, as both players kind of hunkering down and just kind of chilling out and building lots of buggy, creepy, zergy stuff. So army supply is going to be dead even, actually. Very nice. Dwarfy actually taking the worker supply lead. Kind of surprising, considering that Matrix has had the second base here for quite a while. And on the second base, he does have a total of 9 larvae, and he's injecting more and more. But he is floating around 900 minerals, so there's that. And metabolic boost finishing for both players now. We're actually just in time for Dwarfy. And Matrix, he responded by simply just waving at the 4 Zerglings that he knows of, and just goes right on by. So Matrix is going to be flooding now the third base, trying to punish Dwarfy for his greediness now. Even on the other side of the map, we do have the 4 Zerglings taking over the mineral line, and the drones, fight drones, attack, no, drones, you're not attacking, you're just getting in the way. He loses the queen. No, Matrix, he lost the queen to three Zerglings. Action all around. Bailing just coming out here, and the drones are finally going to be able to clean up the atrocity. Well, they clean it up, and now there they go. They're finally going to get back to work. So they are going to clean up the atrocity known as the death of the queen to three Zerglings. And Dwarfy does indeed pay for it with his third hatchery. So nice job by Matrix there. Matrix had the right idea. It's just the execution was a little bit lacking. But again, we're not going to blame him for it because this is... what are you doing, Matrix? Matrix, what are you doing? Here comes Dwarfy. Dwarfy going to be sending all 24 of his army supply, or actually it's going to be, I guess, 20 army supply, and then making a ton of Bane Lingus. Now Matrix is trying to go straight for Mutatech. Unfortunately, I don't think he's going to have a base before the Spire gets done. He did lose the Queen, which hasn't been rebuilt, by the way. He is floating about 1,500 minerals in there. And here comes the Waddle of Banelings. Someone tell Angelicar she's about to miss her Banelingus. They're pink Banelings, too. So every female StarCraft player is jumping for joy. Here come the Banelings, and... I think they may have killed two drones total with that. As there's the... Matrix, he is going for a third base. Very good indeed. Technically going to be, I guess, the fourth, but... will he cancel the queen? No. He won't be canceling the queen. Spire does get taken out. Spawny Pool also get taken out. And he is going to lose the lair. But luckily, he does have ninja bases all over the map. As, again, we... Oh, Matrix, will you run from the Broodlings? Yes. Taking a look from the Dwarfy cam here. He does know... Well, he knows that there's something on the map. Where? He's not quite sure. So we do have the spawning pool, and hilariously enough, Matrix was able to build another spire before his lair went down. Here's the spire coming down. So theoretically, the spire may finish before the spawning pool. Oh no, it was spotted. It has been spotted, Matrix. Matrix, run. Get out of there, drones. All you have to do, okay, you have to micro this perfectly, and you can get out maybe one Mutalisk. But no, it's not going to happen. Matrix losing everything. Army supply. Is that? Workers lost. Kind of on the Dwarfy side. Down goes the spawning pool. Matrix back down to two bases. 38 more Lings coming out for Dwarfy. APMs flying off the handle. 64 APM for the Silver Leaguer. Now we'll go to the Matrix cam. Matrix, what are you looking at, Matrix? Well, I do have a hatchery. Well, I've got a queen. And... get up there and build! No, Matrix, no! Matrix, send the drones back! Find the drone, get them! Box them! Drones, you guys come back over here now. Alright. And GG is called! Dwarfy takes game number two and series number one. Oh, Matrix, we were all rooting for you. I was rooting for you, Matrix! I was rooting for you super duper hard. I really wanted Matrix to win that. So Dwarfy is going to take game two, series number one here on Friday Night Fan Fights number seven. Coming at you live on twitch.tv/Invicta. Also on the VODs, youtube.com/Invicta316. That is just series number one, ladies and gentle spoons. Yes, indeed. Again, if you don't know what Friday Night Fan Fights is, it is the weekly show where I commentate best of threes, three best of threes between fans. At the very end, the live Twitch chat votes on who gets to play the final boss. Who will the final boss be this week? Will it be a professional StarCraft II player? Will it be myself? Will it be a member of the StarCraft II community? Only I know that. And even right now, it's still a little bit iffy because I haven't heard back from our final boss yet. Hopefully we're going to be able to hear from them, but if not, then we will have to improvise, I guess. So again, congratulations to Dwarfy taking game number two in the first series, and a shout out to Matrix for being spectacular. And I was rooting for you. I really was. I was certainly rooting for you. Matrix indeed. So we are getting ready for game number one here in series number two. It is going to be another bronze v bronze. Because I love the Bronzies. The Bronze League heroes of the world are they're my people. They are just I don't know how else to say it other than just my people. They make me feel good inside, and I think I can relate to them the best. Let's put it that way. And so it is going to be a bronze v. bronze here, ZVP. Let me make sure they are ready. Let me make sure they are ready. I got to reset the score really quickly. I do have to reset the score, and I think it was on the left scoreboard here. Yes, it is indeed. So, series number two, ready to start here on Friday Night Fan Fights number 7. Both players are ready, and we are going up again. And actually, no, it's going to be another ZVZ. Apparently, one of them decided to change races right at the last second. So, it's going to be a bronze v. bronze ZVZ here on Heavy Rain LE, the new ladder map. Part of the new, the season whatever. I think this is season 4 of HOTS. I could be wrong on that. But I'm looking forward to it. We're loading it on up. Poor Matrix. I really was rooting for Matrix, honestly. And yeah, Twitch chat was also rooting for Matrix as well. Extra special shout out to Matrix. You are the man, sir. Here we are on Heavy Rain, spawning in the northern spawn, northwestern spawn, playing as the Yellow Zerg. He is a bronze leaguer. Goes by the name of Liminu. And spawning on the southeastern corner, playing as the Pink Zerg, also a bronze leaguer. He goes by the name of Tainern. So Lehman versus Tainern. Sounds like complicated cooking ingredients for a foreign dish. You take a dash of Lehman and a pinch of Tainern, mix it all together, saute it in the pan, and then cry because you burnt everything and you have to start over again. So yes, it is going to be another ZVZ. Again, one of our players, I'm not going to name them, they may rhyme with Lehman. Originally picked Protoss, but then switched right at the last second to Zerg. So I thought it was going to be a ZVP, but again, it's going to be a ZV. It's going to be a ZVZ. No ZVP in sight. So both players macroing up. APMs flying off the handle. 27 and 43. Lehman setting keyboards afire. And both these players going to be scouting again. I don't know how familiar each of these players are with the new ladder maps. They're probably actually a little bit more than more familiar than me because I just don't ladder anymore because I'm awful. As the overlords are going to be swiftly walking by each other, flying by each other, saying, "Good day to you, sir. Do you have any Grey Poupon I could borrow?" And we are going to get a 15 hatch expansion started right away for Tainern. On the other side of things, Lehman, however, is going to be going for his own 15 pool and then 15 hatch, most likely. So Tainern going for the economic route, Lehman going for the safer route. As we are going to see that 15 hatch dropping down at any moment. And there it goes. And there it goes. almost made a caster mishap there. So yeah, so Heavy Rain is a... I'm not a huge fan of this map. I have played, like I said, a couple of unranked maps or matches on this map before, and I'm not a huge fan of it as a Zerg player. There's a lot of choke-offs here, and I don't know what... I really don't honestly know what the fascination with choke points are in StarCraft II. It's actually kind of a trend that's always been... kind of hanging around since Wings of Liberty, even during the beta days with Lost Temple and that sort of thing. For some reason, the Blizzard maps seem to have an emphasis on, okay, well, we're just going to make a choke at your natural expansion. It's going to be a really wide open third that's going to be hard to defend, but your natural and your main are both going to be choked off, and it's very, very difficult for Zerg to do pretty much anything, unless if it's a ZVZ. ZVZ is about the only matchup on this map that the choke will not work for, or work against them, I should say. But against going against Terran player, again, this wall off, very, very easy to accomplish. You can either set your bunkers here, or factories, or even put a couple of barracks down there as well. And obviously, the very, very narrow ramp. Same thing goes over for the natural expansion. The only bad thing, well, the only good thing for Terran players, another bad thing for Zerg players, because it actually works pretty well for Protoss and for Terran, as we do see First Blood being drawn there by Lehman's Queen, is that another thing I really hate about this map is that on the natural expansions, there's a lot of open space. Proxy pylons go down, lots of drops, very, very difficult to defend. It's just not a very good Zerg map, in my opinion. Some people may say that I'm biased, that we have a whole round of 7 drones come out for Lehman here, as both these players looking to go for the later game stages. Jeff 4 Zergalingus making their way out here towards the natural expansion of Tainern. And Tainern apparently is not too worried about getting supply block, just now starting those double overlord production. And, oh, look at that. Taner actually returning the favor. Lehman getting supply blocked now. So Taner is actually going to be on supply block before Lehman will be. And, again, I'm interested to see what Lehman does with these four Zerglings here. He's not making a Baneling nest, and he's got nothing too hot, nothing too sexy going on as far as tech is concerned. So he's just going to be supply blocked. And now 16 Zerglings being made here for Taneurn. And he will have the metabolic boost. It's about 65% done. As he will, looks like he's going to try to be doing a little bit of poking on the natural expansion. He would be correct because this would be a very, very strong play right now. He did do a very nice job scouting the natural expansion as well as the main base with his overlords. He did pay for it with an overlord death, but it's going to pay off for him in spades. And here we go. Lehman knows that there's a ton of Zerglings on the way. Again, no Baneling nest for either of these players. Oh, Lehman, you can't lose any Zerglings there. You got to bring them back. Army supply tab, actually in Lehman's favor. Take that back. He is going to start making a Baneling nest, but will it be up in time? The answer is no, because we are going to have metabolic boost. Did it get canceled? No, it actually finished. I think that my game client may be bugged here because I don't see wings on those Zerglings. That's kind of odd. Oh, there they are. Now they're. That was weird graphical glitch there. And a complete slaughterhouse in favor of Lehman. Good lord. That wasn't even close. I mean, not even close. How many units were lost there? It's going to be the tune of 22 units lost. And Lehman actually has lost more resources there, but that is because of that one overlord. So very nice job there. Nice hold by Lehman. How many workers died there? About four. And not really a great trade for Taneurn, but now he's going to have to worry about dealing with Lehman because Lehman does have the Baneling nest up, which I don't think did Taneurn actually spot that. Yes, he did. Hopefully he was paying attention enough. Again, both these are going to be Bronze League players, so anything can happen when it's Bronze League heroes. As Taneurn building tons of Zerglings. Oh, this is going to come down to micro. This is going to come down to Bronze League hero micro as the nice cancel there by Taneurn. He is going to supply block himself, but he is making four overlords at a time now, so he will be on supply block here relatively shortly. And he does have the tech lead. He does have the metabolic boost. He's got it. And look at this, six Banelings being morphed outside of the natural expansion. Will Taneurn? Oh, Taneurn, I hope your APM is prepared. 48 APM coming up from Taneurn. All right, all you have to do is micro this perfectly, and here we go. Six Banelings, everything getting boxed. It's going to be 12 Zerglings and six Banelings. Where's the micro? Banelings waddling on in there, going straight for the mineral line. One Baneling actually detonates on the queen. Oh, he actually detonated all on drones. Taneurn, don't aim move into that. Oh, God. Oh, it's a Zergling massacre. And the queen even getting taken out by Lehman's Zergling. Somehow that happened. So it is going to be, again, a little bit in favor of Lehman now. Just a hair. But Taneurn does have the better economy, although Lehman is now getting his third expansion up. So somewhat of a wonky trade-off there for Taneurn, and he didn't really have to lose the queen, and he unfortunately A-moved into a wall of Banelings and lost most of his Zerglings. But either way, right now, it is going to be army supply lead in favor of Taneurn, as he does now have roaches. And Taneurn... Taneurn, you have to realize that if you thwart an attack like that, your only method is a counterattack and send the house to your opponent's base. We are going to have six more Banelings being underway. Centrifugal hooks also being researched for Lehman here, or I guess it could be Lehman. I'm just going to say Lehman because that's hilarious. So we do have roaches. Will they detonate on the roaches? You bet they will. All Banelings dead. All roaches alive. Three drones just because. And Taneurn, is he going to press the attack? No. All right. Well, Taneurn, he's completely satisfied with that. He's just going to hold. Everyone, job well done. Time to go get some breakfast. Let's all go to Denny's or Hi-Op. Army supply tab again is going to be favoring Taneurn here, who has been on Lair Tech for quite some time. He's also going for he is going for pneumatized carapace, so we may get to see some overlord drapus possibly. We are going to have Hydralisk now coming out for Lehman. Here in game number one of the best of three. Second best of three on Friday Night Fan Fights number 7. There's too many ones. Too many ones in the title. We're going to have muscular augmentation and the Galio reconstitution being made. Roach speed, Hydra speed on the way, as well as plus one missile attack, plus one ground carapace for Lehman's army. And taking a look at the upgrades, non-existent here for Tainer. And does Tainer even have an Evo Chamber? No, he doesn't. He's just now dropping two of them down. So his tech will be very, very behind Lehman's. Now, fortunately for Tainer, Lehman is not trying to take any sort of offensive position in this game thus far. As we go to the Lehman cam here, he has been pretty much passive. He did go for the early aggression with the Zerglings. He thwarted the attack, the counterattack from Tainer, and now he is just going to be massing up all them roaches and all them Hydralisks. As everyone in Twitch chat rooting for the Zerg. Good job. Thank you, Twitch chat. I would not expect anything less. Arm supply tap again. Going to be in favor of Tainern here. As Lehman is going to be taking the third hatchery here. And again, it's going to be roach on roach on Hydra roach action. Which sounds like a really bad horror movie. Or alternatively, a very, very, very bad fanfic. I'll let the chat decide which one. Overlord speed is now done with Noomtai's Carapace for Tainern. And again, both players just kind of doing absolutely nothing. Building up their armies, teching up. Tainern now going for the 1-1 upgrades for the roaches. Very, very nice indeed. It's going to be very huge in this battle. Three more roaches on the way for Lehman, who's about to be supply blocked. But that's all right, because he's building four overlords. 1-1 already complete for Lehman here. 15 minutes down as we approach the mid-game in game number 1, Friday Night Fan Fights number 7, best of 3, numero dos. My name is Invicta. I'll be your host. I'll be your concierge of the evening, your caster. And isn't that a scary sight? That's a scary sentence for me to say that I'm a caster. I don't know if I can consider myself a caster. I'd prefer to leave that title to the professionals. And Lehman going for the somewhat metagame-breaking approach to just putting two drones in every extractor. Very, very good indeed. Making sure we don't have any more of that shenaniganery, tomfoolery happening on the map. Nope, just going to be the third expansion. As we are going to have a Spire now being produced for Lehman. So Lehman playing for the ultra late game now. It does look like he's not going to be moving out anytime soon. Well, I take that back. JK, this is Bronze League. Sinvicta, you don't know anything about this game. Army supply is 78-74 in favor. Or actually, now it's going to go swing way in favor of Tainern, who's making a round of roaches and 8 overlords. Yes, indeed, because when you make a lot of roaches, you got to make sure you make a lot of overlords. And here we go. Whose upgrades will be better? 2-2, nearly complete for Lehman. It looks like he is going to stop and wait for that, possibly. Tainern, on the other hand. No, Lehman's actually just going to go for it. He's on equal. I don't know about this attack. He should definitely wait for the 2-2 here. But either way, here we go. Tainern rapidly making 19 roaches. Roaches, everybody gets roaches. The attack is, well, the attack is about as, it's about as roachy on roachy as you can think. And people talking about the fanfic now. Thank you, Twitch chat. So Tainer going to be running away with this one. I really feel like Lehman should have definitely waited for his 2-2 upgrade, although he does have the Hydro Searcher not being focused by the roaches, but here comes the other swarm of roaches from Tainern, and they are going to finally get chased out of there. Unit's Lost Tab going to be in favor of still Tainern, as he did murder a bunch of Hydralis there. And then he takes out his aggression. Takes out his aggression on the poor destructible rocks. Lehman forced to go back home and lick his wounds. 2-2 is now complete. 2-2 almost complete for Tainern. And we're just going to kind of reset. It's Tainern going to be grouping all those overlords outside in front of the one queen here. Again, she is taking a vacation, kind of sunning herself in the shade, which doesn't make any sense because you can't sun yourself in the shade, herpa derpa. But she's just kind of chilling out with a margarita, hiding from her overmind master. She doesn't want to be spending that energy making creep tumors. No, 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 no. Queens do enjoy themselves a Bloody Mary and a margarita, I dare say. Two overseers just checking to make sure the rocks are still there. And yes, they are indeed. As Lehman inexplicably taking the long way around. And Tainern just going to let him do that. Arm supply tab going to be heavily, heavily in favor of Tainern. 2-2 is nearly complete for Tainern. Lehman is going to have a slight tech lead here, but he just does not have the numbers. 5 Infestors, 15 Hydras now. Being made for Tainern, and it's going to be a walkover, a move fest. See you later, Lehman. All of his army thrown away. And I would say that he's making room to get himself some Mutalisks, but unfortunately, that's not the case because he made the Spire, and then decided not to do anything with it as he is remaking the Hydras and the Roaches. So again, this is going to be a Bronze League action, Bronze League, Bronzy 1v1. I almost said Bronze League Hero. If I say Bronze League Hero, I don't mean it. I guess I do mean it, but not in like a derogatory way. Whenever I say Bronze League Hero, that's kind of like looking at a dog that you know is really not smart, but he's just so darn cute. He's just adorable, I guess. And that's how it's a term of endearment is how I would characterize that. As a huge army now finally making their way past the neutral no-fly zone that both these players have established here. A gentleman's agreement that neither army will be facing each other in the mid. Both are just going to kind of A-move on each other's ground, and that is just going to be that. Plus 3-3 now on the way for Tainer, and actually who's going to be taking the tech lead, and Lehman is going to be in a lot of trouble here. He is not going to like what he sees. Down goes the fourth hatch of Lehman, and that hatch is pretty much impossible to hold in a ZBZ, and here we go. Oh, no, the Infestors! Infestors all getting sniped. Only one Fungal went out. The Hydralis doing a nice job focus firing. I still don't think it's going to matter, though. Tainern easily walking over this. Again, 3-3, about 40% done for Tainern. He is going to have the tech lead, but right now both armies are going to be 2-2. 11 Roaches, 2 Hydras being made for Lehman, but I don't know if it's going to be in time or even enough. Even if he had that right now, it's not enough to stop this. That's just simply too many Hydras. And, oh, Mutalisks. Mutalisks, good unit, not versus Hydras. As Lehman is finding out, GG is called. Tainern takes game number one in the second best of three. Oh boy, that one. I feel like Lehman had a couple of really golden opportunities, but unfortunately, it was thrown away. So Tainern taking game number one here, Bronzy on Bronzy ZVZ action. As we get ready to go to game number two, it is going to be again a ZVZ here. It's going to be Bronze v. Bronze. And I'm waiting confirmation from our final boss. I don't know if they're going to make it tonight. I have not heard back from them. But I will make it work either way. We may have to improvise. We'll have to wait and see. So we do have Tainern in the game. And where is Lehman? Looking for Lehman. Make sure you stay inside of the chat room. Make sure you stick around for the duration of the night because, like I said, at the end of the third best of three, we are going to be voting. The Twitch chat is going to be voting to find out which of the winners will be facing the final boss. Will it be a professional hero? Or will it be a professional hero? Will it be a professional player? Will it be myself? Will it be a member of the StarCraft II community? And Lehman did throw out the GG last game, too. So here we go. It's going to be on Acolon Waste. Game one going to Tainern. Game two is about to happen right now. We're loading it on up. Again, welcome out to Friday Night Fan Fights number 7 here, twitch.tv/Sinvicta. Also on my VODs, on my YouTube channel, youtube.com/Sinvicta316. The very, very, very popular Friday Night Fan Fights. Everybody loves it. Everybody loves it. And we're loading it up right now. No, it's not Liquid Hero. Spawning on Acolon Wastes in the Northwestern expansion. Northwestern spawn. He is one game up playing as the Pink Zerg. He's a Bronze Leaguer. He goes by the name of Tainern. And spawning on the southeastern corner of the map. I may have said northeastern. I meant northwestern. Spawning on the southeastern corner of the map, currently trailing 1-0. He had a couple of good ideas in the last game. Unfortunately, he just got out macro. He's playing the Yellow Zerg, also a Bronze Leaguer. He goes by the name of Lehman. So here we are, Tainern saying we don't need luck. We just need to have fun. Yes, indeed. All of us have fun, indeed. And as I was saying here, as we get in the opening stages of game number two between the second best of three between these two Bronze League gladiators, I feel like Lehman had a good idea, roughly an idea of what to do. Just the problem is that his macro kind of faltered himself a little bit, and then the awkwardly timed counterattack with the Baneling A move on the Queens didn't really quite work out so well, and the follow up Baneling A move on the Roaches also does not work out too well normally anyway. as Lehman is going, as I'm sorry, Taynern is going to be sending out that Overlord, scouting the northeastern portion of the map over here, just in case if there's any sort of scouting medevacs or warp prisms, anything like that. He doesn't have to worry about some sort of doom drop, as Lehman is going to go for the 15 pool, as Taynern going for the 16 hatch before pool. Actually even getting the gas as well, Taynern tearing it up. Going for the super-duper greedy. Actually, it's not super-duper greedy. And look at this. Lehman is also going to be moving out here, taking the 15 hatch. I think that might have been the 14 hatch. Not quite sure. But Lehman will have the spawning pool up. And again, it is going to be... It is going to be... interesting. I'm curious to see what Lehman will do. Because, like I said, he did have the right idea in that last game. It just... The execution was just not there. And not that we're expecting a whole lot, because we are talking about Bronze League heroes and Bronze League players. But we are going to have a couple of Zerglings, pair of Zerglings now being made and heading out and then stopping. Checking out their Mohawks, shifting around and just doing a little bit happy jazz hands, I think, and wagging their tails. Anytime I see a Zergling move, and I have to credit Disciples of Mayhem, Kay Hammett, also known as my real-life best friend. He's the one who got me into StarCraft 1. And anytime I see a Zergling move, regardless if they have speed or not, I always envision them going, oh boy, oh boy, oh boy, oh boy. Like, they're just a very excitable golden retriever. And that definitely helps this analogy, because these are actually yellow Zerglings. So anytime, you're not going to be able to unsee that now. Anytime you see a Zergling move across the map, or just move in general, they look like they're just galloping, frolicking, happy golden retrievers. And they say, oh boy, oh boy, oh boy, oh boy, oh boy. Yes, yes, I have nothing to talk about in the early game stages here in a ZVZ. So Army Supply tab going to be 11-7 in favor of Taynern, who did opt for the more macro heavy approach, taking a 16 hatch, 15 gas, 15 pool. Lehman made the early Zerglings and then decided to not do anything with them, opting to go for a very, very early third expansion here. And again, something that I would say to a newer Zerg player would be something to the effect of, if you opt to go for the early spawning pool, and you know that you're probably going to have more Zerglings at the time anyway than your opponent, I'm not quite sure. Yes, so Lehman did spot the expansion here. You need to do something with the Zerglings, not just keep them outside of your natural expansion. You went early spawning pool for a reason. And unless your idea of early spawning pool was to go into a baneling defense, something like that, you need to be doing something with these lings instead of just sitting around doing nothing, because that is a lot of minerals. Right, there are 16 lings, that's 400 minerals that are just kind of sitting there. So, again, Lehman is going to be taking a huge economic advantage now if Taynern does not spot this third expansion here. Again, that expansion went down to the 5-minute, 15-second mark. Taynern does have Metabolic Boost, which is now done, and a Baneling Nest also halfway done. Actually, no, that's Lehman's Baneling Nest, a Roach Warren, that's what I meant. I looked at one thing and saw the other. One eye zigged and one eye zagged. And that's not how you look at the production tab. So both these players, again, opting to go for a gentleman's agreement. No rush, 10 minutes, something along those lines. As Roach Warren is now going down here for Lehman as well. I'm pretty sure Lehman has no idea that there's a Roach Warren yet. He hasn't even seen the main base of Taynern. So both players just kind of sitting back, macroing up. And this is what I would call a turtle game. Now, for those of you who don't watch the Wednesday night Bronze League Hero streams, what a turtle game is basically one or both players just kind of sit back and just kind of turtle. They sit there macroing up, getting tech, getting all sorts of goodiness when static defense is concerned, like three spine crawlers, for example. And then sit back, do nothing, and then the entire game culminates in one huge epic battle, and then the game just kind of ends. And that is what I call a turtle game. And, of course, there's certainly nothing wrong with it. They may not be the most exciting games to watch or commentate, but they certainly have their place in this workaday world of medevac drops and hellbats and stimpaks and just Protoss, because Protoss. So Lehman going to be taking the army advantage here, 23-11, and Taynern really freaking out about nothing that exists because there's no spire. Not quite sure what Taynern saw that uh, that made him. Maybe he's just getting extra Overlord scouting protection. Is the only thing I can think of. Tainern making a bunch of spore crawlers here just because. And Lehman, on the other hand, turning every single one of those larvae into... well, both these players actually have a ton of larvae. So macro is slipping a little bit. Not that big of a deal. Again, army supply going to be heavily in favor of Lehman right now. And will Lehman be able to pull this series back and even it? Not quite sure. Tainern is going to be able to spot this. Now, again, I'm not quite sure what triggered Tainern to make all these spore crawlers. He will be very, very safe from any sort of... he'll be safe from any sort of Overlord scouting. That's the only thing I can say. We have a Nidus Swarm now being produced. And it is going to drop on the northern expansion here. I don't think Tainern... now, normally... Again, no disrespect to either one of these players, just because it's all tongue in cheek. But normally, you just normally wouldn't do this. You don't make a Nidus Worm hidden in the northern expansion at any point of any game of any all time. So whenever I see something like this, I immediately just kind of get even happier that I'm watching a Bronze League versus Bronze League game. As Tainern is going to be swooping right on in there to check out the main base, he's going to find out that there's actually no Spire involved at all. There's just going to be no Spire. Nidus Worm is now almost nearly complete. Unfortunately, there's no units to speak of that he can load into. Again, not that big of a deal, but normally you would just never do that. Evo Chambers now being researching 1-1 missile upgrades, actually almost going the exact same time simultaneously for Lehman's upgrade, and again, I'm not quite sure what Tainern saw that made him freak out about the four spore crawlers. I think he built three. No, he built four. But he did not build any spore crawlers in the natural expansion, so he was expecting mutas, but not that many mutas. So at least he had some sort of contingency plan. And again, hiding the Nidus Worm, new meta. That's the only thing I can say. That is new meta. That is really the new meta. Arm supply tab again, almost double in value for Lehman, who is going to be not supply blocked anytime soon. And Lehman, look at this, a double Nidus Worm. Both of these players taking a page out of each other's books. Lehman not giving the notice that you have to hide your Nidus Worm before you use it in Bronze League. And again, we are playing No Rush 15 now. So down goes one Overseer who is somehow killed by one Hydralisk and a Queen, so there's that. Nidus Worm is now complete for Lehman. Let's see what he does with that. As again, Tainern, was the Nidus Worm spotted? No, this is an Overseer for Lehman, and he did not spot the Overseer, not spot the hidden Nidus Worm. So let's try to figure out. Let's logistically go through the thought process of hiding a Nidus Worm. Well, firstly, if you hide a Nidus Worm, you don't have to worry about it ever being spotted by your enemy base and their main base because you just won't do that. Secondly, I will say that the good thing about hiding a Nidus Worm is that the Nidus Worm will be completely fine. The bad thing about doing it is that the Nidus Worm is going to be not only completely fine, but every single unit that you have is not going to be able to be loaded in there. So both Evo Chambers go down. I think, I was able to cancel one of the upgrades. The plus one missile upgrade somehow finished right during that assault. And Lehman following up with 11 more Roaches and 7 more Hydras. He does have a Nidus Worm. He tried to do something with it, so I give him credit for that. But, again, Tainern, it's there. Let's put it that way. Army supply tab, again, actually swinging in favor of Tainern now. That's got to be all Roaches. It's indeed all those Roaches spawning. How many Roaches is that going to be? It's going to be 41 Roaches taking on 23 Roaches. And, again, unfortunately, the... Not only sending one Overlord, but sending one Overlord plus an accompanying 6 Overlords just to make sure that the Nidus Worm is super duper gone and forgotten about. But again, it does look like Tainern is finally going to go for the to go load up in the hidden Nidus Worm. And will this get spotted by Lehman? The answer is absolutely no. Now, interestingly enough, Tainern going for the nicer approach of just showing exactly where his once hidden Nidus Worm is going to be extracting into the main lair is going to be produced. So both these players, again, being very gentlemanly, showing each other's hands before actually playing any cards down on the table. Nidus Worm is now complete, and let's go to the Leman Cam. Leman Cam, oh, we got a bug problem. Somebody get the roach spray. We've got bugs. It's going to be buggy on buggy action here as Leman boxing his entire army, A moving everything into oblivion. And Tainern, this may be an ill-conceived strategy. 1-1 is done for Leman. He does have the armor advantage over the roaches, and that is going to be the difference in this fight. So Leman, no! No, Leman! No, what are you doing? Don't counter worm, you win! Leman! Leman, you haven't lost yet! Don't GG! Don't GG yet! You're fine, dude! You're completely fine! No. Okay, almost! Whew! Whew, almost had a heart attack there. Leman does not GG. Does not GG. Whew. All right. Whew. That one got the old ticker going. That one got the old heart pumping. Let's put it that way. Gonna have an infestation pit being the second infestation pit going down here for Tainern. Again, meta breaking, I dare say, with the hiding of the northern Nidus Worm into the showing the cards when you really didn't have to into the double infestation pit. And Twitch chat's exploding with laughter as the stream is now catching up to the near GG. So a preemptive, almost non-BM GG. We haven't seen one of those in quite a while. You don't even see that on Bronze League Heroes, man. Well, sometimes you do. Sometimes you do. Leman doing some scouting at the third base here. He is going to spot that there is no workers. Will Tainern's roaches make it in time? The answer is probably. And everything's cleaned up. Everything's fine. Everything's looking good. Leman, again, he does have the army supply lead. He's got a nice economy lead as well, although he is starting to run out of money in his main base. He didn't go for a spire. Again, he did make the Nidus Worm, but outside of the one attempt, he does look like he's trying to position this Overseer, which actually hasn't moved in quite a while, for possibly doing another Nidus Worm play. But I just don't know what to think about this. I mean, whenever I see a hidden Nidus Worm into a double infestation pit, into a 19-minute hive, it's these kind of moments that I just sort of ponder. I ponder my StarCraft existence. And I sit back and think, what can I learn from both of these players? Well, Sinvicta, one thing you can learn is how to surprise the heck out of your opponent with a hidden Nidus Worm. The second thing that I learned is that sometimes you can GG without actually GGing, which is completely okay because when you GG, you don't actually GG in the game unless your other player decides to accept your GG, which in that case, they also GG, but you don't have to leave the game because that's just too many GGs. That sentence is going to be a lot. That's going to be a hilarious thing to see on the YouTube closed captioning. I'm interested in seeing what the beta closed captioning on YouTube will read that sentence like. We have an Ultra Lisku cavern coming out for Leman. Unfortunately, he's supply blocked. So there you go on that. He is getting the missile upgrades, plus 3 missile upgrades. Very, very good for helping boost Ultra Lisk DPS. So I'm not quite sure what to think about the Ultralisk switch here. Ultralisks do perform fairly well against roaches when they're upgraded, of course. And these will not be upgraded. They will have plus 3 armor right out of the gate, but will they go for the chitinous plating? I'm not quite sure. The answer is probably, as Leman does have more money than Fort Knox in the bank. Yes, that was a lot of GGs in that statement. So many people watching Friday Night Fan Fights number 7 here on Friday, January 17, 2014. My name is Invicta, and this is part of my weekly program I do every Wednesday, Thursday, Friday here on my Twitch channel. All shows starting at 8 p.m. Central, 9 p.m. Eastern, 6 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. And here comes the main engagement. There's the Fungalingus, Fungaloo coming down here on Tainern's Roaches. Army Supply tab is still in favor of Leman. Tainer desperately trying to get out more roaches. The army supply, again, is still going to be shifting in Leman's favor. Almost said flavor. I'm not sure what Leman would taste like, but I'm sure it tastes kind of rusty. And the Hydralisk doing most of the DPSing. Down goes all the roaches. Tainer may have dropped game number 2. Will we go to a rubber match here in the second best of 3? Infestors being sacrificed for no particular reason at all. Army Supply Tab now dropping heavily for Tainern. Is this the end of Tainern? Are we going to see a Game 3 Lehman playing beautifully? Who almost preemptively GG'd. Is now actually going to win the game, as he should have done about maybe, oh, I don't know, 15 minutes ago. So, GGW! Good game, well played. GG, LOL. And Lehman takes game number 2 here in the best of 3, number 2. On Friday Night Fan Fights, number 7. So congratulations to Lehman for taking control, almost preemptively GGing out of an easy victory, and then pulling it back and winning in the face of a hidden Nidus Swarm play. Bronze League Heroes, I love them. Gotta love them. I love them. And again, if you're just joining us, welcome out to Friday Night Fan Fights number 7. Again, all these VODs will be posted on my YouTube channel, youtube.com/Invicta316. I do all the programming Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, 8 p.m. Central, 9 p.m. Eastern, 6 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. Wednesday, Bronze League Heroes Wednesday. Thursday is Tryhard Thursday in League of Legends. And Friday is, of course, Friday Night Fan Fights. So we got Lehman looking for Tainern. And we're going to go to game number 3. It's the rubber match. It is the rubber match. The final. It's the finale. The epic finale that we've all been waiting for. And again, remember, at the end of Friday Night Fan Fights, you, the Twitch chat, gets to decide on who out of the winners will get the right to play the final boss. Both players are ready to go. The game is loading up as we go to game number 3, the rubber match, in the second ZVZ. Coincidentally, I wasn't trying to go for all Zerg tonight, but apparently that's just sort of going to happen. The map is going to be Polar Knight LE, and the players are going to be, well, they're just Bronze Leaguers, and we love Bronze Leaguers. And yeah, that could have been a lot of Ultralisks. Had the game not ended there, it probably most likely would have ended relatively soon here. Spawning on Polar Knight LE, taking it back, bringing it back to a rubber match in Game 3. He's a Bronze Leaguer playing as the Yellow Zerg. He goes by the name of Lehman. And spawning on the Northern Spawn, playing as the Pink Zerg. He dropped game number 1. I'm sorry, he won game number 1 and then dropped game number 2. He's also a Bronze Leaguer, playing as the Pink Zerg. His name is Tainern. Going for have fun, good luck, instead of good luck, have fun. Both players with interesting, I use interesting in a slightly Kappa tone. Strategy with the Nidus Worms. One electing to hide the Nidus Worm, the other electing to not hide the Nidus Worm, and then just building it and not doing anything with it. Which, again, as far as metagame breaking goes, that tips the scale. Really does. It really, really does. So Overlord just kind of sitting around doing nothing, as Husky would say, and finally decides to go on his way. He goes scout very, very slowly. So again, Polar Knight LE on for a ZVZ is a very, very interesting matchup. Just due to the fact that it's a super, and I mean super duper wide choke point. As I was talking about on Heavy Rain when we saw game number 1 between these two, comparatively speaking to Heavy Rain, this is like a monster, a humongo, ginormous Ultralisk sized ramp here that you have to defend as Zerg. And again, ZVZ matchups are not about walling off, unless you watch Cats play, who's a good friend of mine, by the way, Root Cats. I also moderate for him on his stream. Root Cats, this is actually a good time to bring this up. This is a really, really good time to bring this up here. As we watch Lehman going for a 15 hatch, Tainern again opting to go for the 50 pool. Oh, actually, take it back. Lehman went for a 15 pool, then 15 hatch. So Lehman is going to be quite ahead here for Tainern. The opening stages, but going back to what I was saying, this is actually a really interesting Sinvicta tidbit information for you here. Just a little trivia for Sinvicta. The Sinvicta Ninja Push, which is the strat that I was made famous for, and it did take me to Master Leagues two seasons in a row, and then one season before that. I went Master League, Diamond League, and then Master League with the Ninja Push. Which is basically my patented 14-minute 3-5 Ultralisk push with a bunch of queens. I give full credit. I do not take responsibility for coming up with the idea of the ninja push. I only named it and refined it. But my buddy Root Cats is the one who showed me the ninja push way, way, way back on a Day 9 Daily for Funday Monday. Mask Queens, look it up. A lot of people say it was... not Nurchio. Who was the Zerg player who tried to he didn't try to take credit for it. I forget his name. He's a very, very young guy. He's a really, really popular streamer for Wings of Liberty, and then he kind of fell off after not really going anywhere professionally. I can't believe I'm forgetting his name now. He was super duper young Zerg player. He used to stream all the time. Anyway, a lot of people were giving him credit for the idea of massing queens and then just going straight for either mutas or even roaches. And the idea was done firstly and betterly by Root Cats. And that, again, is the person who I credit the ninja push to. Again, I only named and refined the ninja push. Cats is the one who demonstrated it for me. And he's a good friend of mine. Like I said, as the queen's being micro'd here, he is going to lose the queen to 3 Zerglings. So a little bit of a fumble there by Lehman, who loses his first queen. And again, it's not going to be honestly that big of a deal. Losing your early queen is a huge, huge problem. But whenever you do have a base up on your opponent, even though you don't know it right now, as long as you rebuild it immediately, it's not that big of a deal. As we are going to have a queen, will the queen be able to supply block Tainern here? That'd be huge for Lehman. The answer is no. Spanishiwa, thank you. Yeah, Spanishiwa, thank you to Buffzar. Buffzar? Buffzar, yeah, Spanishiwa. A lot of people were giving credit to Spanishiwa for coming up with the mass queens, going for the mass transfusing, and that was done way, way, way before Spanishiwa ever started getting popular on StarCraft by Rootcats. Again, check out the Day 9 Daily. I don't remember the exact number of it, but it was a Funday Monday. If you go to YouTube, just YouTube Day 9, just YouTube Funday Monday Queens, and you will see a part 2 of the Encore presentation. That is where Cats sent in 5 games to Sean, and he covers the Ninja Push. Again, it didn't have a name for it because the Funday Monday challenge was you must always be producing a queen on every cooldown with every hatchery throughout the entire game. And the Funday Monday ended up turning out to be more of a learning experience than an actual Funday Monday, which is very, very cool indeed. I started doing it, and Kat showed me it, and I just played it. That is my build, and I give Kat's full credit for it. Yes, that was Spanishiwa, so thank you on that one here. Army Supply going to be in favor of Tainern right now, 19-14. But again, Lehman is going to have the third hatchery up way before Tainern. Will this be a good or bad thing? We'll have to wait and find out here as Tainer is going to be taking every single one of his Zerglings, 26 Zerglings, making their way. Oh boy, oh boy, oh boy, oh boy, oh boy, oh boy, oh boy. That's what they look like, I'm telling you. Here we go, A moving into the wall of Lehman Zerglings, and they're going to back up. Actually, Tainer surprisingly backing up there. He has the number advantage. I'm not quite sure why he's getting so freaked out. He may be expecting a Baneling Nest, and he's going to have to pull on out of there. And I don't even think, yeah, Tainern did spot the creep. Does he actually know that there's a base there? I'm not quite sure. Again, both these players are going to be Bronze Leakers, so they may not possess the, the alertiveness, the decisiveness to see or to deduce what they scout, as it is going to be a Bronze. Bronze v. Bronze, ZVZ. My first bottle of water is now cashed, unfortunately. So Tainern, again, facing a nasty supply block, just now starting four Overlords, and that has been a constant problem for him. Luckily for him, Lehman was also supply blocked, so there you go. Again, Army Supply Tab is going to be in favor of Tainern right now, and he is going to spot the third hatchery finally and go straight for it. Now, will Lehman be able to stop this hatchery from going down? He needs to have this hatchery survive. Otherwise, risking life and limb there for the early hatchery is not going to pay off, but that is enough Banelings to scare off all the Zerglings for Tainern. Neither player really building anything. Goliath over Constitution just now starting for Tainern, who looks like he's going to be investing heavily into Roaches again, as both these players have been playing pretty much Roach heavy this entire series. Almost an extended series, I would say. So double Evo Chamber coming out in air for Lehman, who is going to try to catch up in tech. Luckily, he doesn't have to catch up because there's no Evo Chambers. Yep, no Evo Chambers for Lehman. Here and again, welcome out to Friday Night Fan Fights. This is only the second best of 3 here on Friday Night Fan Fights number 7. My name is Sinvicta. Yes, I do like to act that I'm a commentator. I'm not really a commentator. I just play one on TV. Let's put it that way. I'm a caster, if you will. And make sure you tune in Wednesday for Bronze League Hero Wednesdays. Thursdays, let's try our Thursday League of Legends. Very, very popular show. And, of course, the most popular show that I do is Friday Night Fan Fights. Everyone loves it. Well, I take that back. The as far as viewers are concerned, Bronze League Heroes pulls in more viewers than the Friday Night Fan Fights. Friday Night Fan Fights number two, though. I love it. Banelings waddling their way up here. Here come the Roaches. Actually, there's going to be a surprise amount of Roaches coming out from Tainurn. And I don't think Lehman was quite ready for this, as the Roach numbers are going to heavily favor Tainer now, and he's just going to be able to bust up this third hatchery without suffering really any losses here. Take a look at units lost tab. Heavily, heavily in favor of Tainer right now. Army supply tab is actually going to be favoring Lehman as he's trying to desperately get out 11 Roaches. Unfortunately, he did not. Oh, no, Lehman. Lehman, no, Lehman, you didn't bind. Lehman forgetting to hotkey his third hatchery there, and the reason why I know that is because on top of seeing it on his three key, he actually had a bunch of unspent larva there. I was looking for Roaches to spawn there to possibly try to save the hatchery. Did not happen. Army supply tab dead even. Taking a look at the tech. Again, 1-1 is just now starting for Lehman. Actually, he's going to have, for some reason, he started Ground Carapace way before missile attacks. And Tainer, no! Tainer, what are you backing off for? Yeah, Tainer! Tainer, you have complete map dominance right now, dude. You don't need to be backing up. Oh, macro hatch coming out here for Tainer. He doesn't have the economy to be dropping a macro hatch right now. He should be taking a third base. Take a third base here. This is going to be Sinvicta's amateur tip of the day, because I'm not pro. Master League does not mean that you're a pro. Let's put it that way. But what I will say for my amateur tip of the day, if you launch a successful raid and you take out a base of your opponent, please, by all means, take your own. Win ahead, get more ahead. And certainly don't be throwing down macro hatches, yes. He is going to get that third base here, but that third base should have been up a long time ago. I mean, a long time ago. 13 minutes is a long time for a Zerg player to not be on three bases. And, so Tainurn. Tainer kind of fumbling there a little bit. I'm not saying that Tainer may or may not win this game, because he certainly has a huge lead right now, but there's no reason for him to back off. And if he is going to back off, you at least take these Onaga Watchtowers, grab yourself a third expansion, hell, even going for a fourth expansion, and hell, you can even take this one up here, take a fifth expansion if you want. Win ahead. Please, by all means, get more ahead, but make sure that you maintain map awareness and map control, and that all involves vision. And with vision, make sure you take out those Onaga Watchtowers. They're there for a reason. Neither one of these players really using it, but again, both these players are going to be bronze leaguers, so we're not going to be holding them to any sort of higher level of play. And apparently, Twitch is saying Master League does make you pro-ish. No. No. Just because I made it to Master League three times does not make me pro-ish in any way. If you want to have pro, real honest to God pro Zerg tips, please watch my friend Rootcats on his stream. He streams almost every day. Wednesday is his Espanol Wednesday, which is hilarious because Cats only speaks in Spanish. And that's where I try to bone up on my Espanol, which is absolute garbage right now. So it's going to kind of even out here. Tainurn actually is in huge supply, almost doubles army supply lead, but he's not doing anything with it right now. He looks like he is waiting for upgrades, but he's going to be heavily, heavily behind in upgrades because 2-2 is going to be complete at the same time of 1-1, and Lehman actually getting his third base. Hell, he could go up to a fourth base right now without impunity. And we are going to have a Nidusworm now being made at the what should have been the fourth base coming out here for Tainurn. But Lehman may think that he's in that lead right now, but he is in a massive, massive disadvantage right now. And I mean super duper massive. So here we go. Is Tainer going to be able to spot it? He's looking for the Nidus Worm. We are on the Tainer cam right now. Freaking out. Where is that Nidus Worm? Where's the Nidus Worm? Well, maybe it was a troll worm. It was a troll just worm. Tainer unable to find it. He says, "Well, I'm just going to pretend I didn't hear that." As he is now shifting his entire army, still freaking out, trying to find out where the non-existent Nidus Worm is. And he's just going to go right back to injecting. Oh, we found it! We found it! Run it! Attack! Attack! Tainurn engaging Lehman, finding out, whoa, that's a way bigger army than I thought he had. That is a way bigger army. as Tanner gets the full surround. Oh, the concave too much. Concave too strong, plus two armor, very good. But not when you're taking, oh, I don't know, that much of an army supply disadvantage. So Tanner completely raffle stomps Lehman's army. Is he gonna take out the Nidus Worm? Yes, indeed, he sees it. There you go. And yes, the Nidus Worm does produce creep, for those of you who didn't know. No, Tanner, just attack! Just attack! He wiped out his entire army! There's no reason to get upgrades! No, Tanner! Tanner, you've got lethal on the board! If this is Hearthstone, you have lethal on the board, Tanner! He's just gonna macro up. 13 more roaches being reduced. This is giving Lehman enough time to spend the massive amounts of minerals in his bank, and he's just not going to attack. So another Sinvicta amateur tip of the day here. And again, this will be strike two for Tanner, which, again, I'm not going to make fun of because he is a Bronze League player, but whenever you do find yourself completely and utterly destroying your opponent's entire army and getting the Nidus Worm to boot, don't sit back and macro. That is not a time. You are basically saying, I am going to block this three-point shot of yours, but I'm going to give you the ball back, even though you're on the other side of the court. And I am out of bounds. That is what you were saying for those of you who watch basketball, and I don't really watch basketball because it's a boring sport. But theoretically, that's what's happening. So Tanner finally boxing all of his roaches. How many roaches? 64 roaches. As Tanner should be able to easily stomp anything that Lehman has. Lehman is trying to get out an infestation pit. And actually, he did get the infestation pit, but he has no infestors to speak of. And here we go. Here comes the A moving. It's going to be 2-2 roaches taking on 1-1 roaches. But that's so many more roaches. Drones being pulled off the line. Attack drones. Army spy. 106 to 56 and falling. Tanner finally driving it home. Nail in the coffin. And Lehman, after pulling it back, winning game two, is going to unfortunately drop game number three. Lehman, GG's out of there. There you go. Tanner does indeed finish it. So congrats to Tanner for getting the second best of three victory. Yes, indeed. That was difficult to watch, let's put it that way. And I'm getting messaged by someone very important on Skype. So, but again, congrats to Tanner here, as we are going to be starting the game, the third best of three here on Friday Night Fan Fights. Number.